Remember ye not the former things.
Neither consider the things of old.
Behold,
I will do a new thing.
Everybody
say new.
Now shall spring forth, shall ye not know it?
God said, I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in desert places.
Yes, you do.
Behold, I will do a new thing. I want to use from the topic tag this today, the expectation of new. One more time, just say new. Y'all can have a seat. It's quite the norm to have an expectation of newness in life.
Yes.
And before I keep going, I do want to give again my condolences to Brother Cruz and Trustee Everett for y'all loss. And it was a wonderful service this week. And so God really bless. And Dobie was a major part of this ministry. And real quick, I tell you, she used to make these orange juice cakes for me when I go out of town. And I never told no one who made them. Actually, I lied. I told her, I made it. But it's quite normal to have an expectation of newness in your life. Everybody wants something new. This is not the expectation for only those that's part of the faith, but rather it's for the secular as well. Everybody wants something new. It's shouted out on both the religion and the secular. It is at least a shouted out one time per year when the clock ticks and the year turns. And we go, Happy New Year. Thus, the expectation of happy should then follow us, all based upon the timing of a clock, the turning of another year, and happy, and once you say happy in a new year, it all should go together. In the new year, the expectation of, but it's not limited to, when you go into a new year, we expect certain things, like we set new goals, we put up new vision, with expectation of perhaps new homes, new cars, new jobs, new positions, a new boo, a new body, new and high hopes, new dreams, new joy, new happiness. Some folk want new iPhones. new thoughts that life now has succumbed to this phrase, Elder Stanley, out with the old and in with the new. Now, we all remember that for the next several weeks of January, we are walking around mysteriously declaring new. Everybody say new. While in reality, much is still the same. Same body. Same pay rate, same job, same bills, same struggles, same headaches, same stress, same car problems, same relationship problems, same disappointment year after year. So then we change our language. We get around February, watch our language change from Happy New Year. We change the language, we change the conversation from Happy New Year, then we say, how's it going? And the response that we have in our culture is, you know, man, same old, I can't call it. Even when the expectation of new and a better year fail us, we may get one more shot at it. And it's our special birthday tweet and post declaring new, and yet it's again, this is a new chapter. Happy birthday. Somehow we saying that our teen years, our 20s and our 30s and even our 40s caused so much pain, it's done us so wrong that certainly this is my chapter that's about to change everything. This should be the best chapter of my life. Uh-huh. Only to find out that the last time you was really happy is when you didn't even know what it was like to pay a bill. The last time you was truly happy was before you ever got married. It was before the children. Before the child support. The last time you was happy was before the eviction, before the repo, before the foreclosure, before you ever got fired, before you felt abandoned. I'm speaking to someone who's in a posture this morning, in a posture where life created a thought that suggests this, that perhaps life would have been better if I never was even born. Speaking to someone who feel it would be better off even today if perhaps I was dead. Despite how real life situations may have threatened you, your self-esteem, your consciousness, making you feel hopeless before you throw in your towel of defeat, God Himself declared this with great expectation in His Word, I will do a new thing. Everybody say new. Look at with me in the scripture if you would again, verse 18. Remember ye not the things of old, neither consider, remember ye not the former things, I'm sorry, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth, shall ye not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in desert places. It was their memory that served them right, the children of Israel, their memory. Now they've been in captivity for the past 5 decades, feeling abandoned and feeling forgotten by God, having reason to fear that life would never get any better than what they've been through so far. Some now was there at the beginning of captivity, they died off, and some now who was born in captivity never knew what it was like to even be free. They never even experienced what it was like to be in the joy of the Lord. They felt that it was because of their own failures, their own sins, their own fault, that God was not with them anymore. They felt as a life has now drowned them and burnt them out. And I'm not speaking of the second, I'm speaking of the children of God who never experienced God, who never knew what it felt like to be with God. In other words, they felt like misfits. imprisoned by their own sinful lifestyles by now. They felt that the Lord was perhaps angry with them. Now experiencing the judgment of God, because when you go to the book of Isaiah from chapter 1 all the way through 42, it's so much judgment the prophet is talking about. And so now they feel like that God has judged them, and now they're experiencing the wrath of God, and they're suffering. And if you could say, let's give them a testimony, they would have said it this way: when life is bad, it is bad. However, at the strangest turn of events, God desired something new for their lives. Everybody said new. He desired something new for them. If you look over in verse 4, Isaiah chapter 43, verse 4, this is what it said. It said, since thou was precious in my sight, thou hast been honorable, and I have loved thee. Therefore will I give men for thee and people for thy life. I'm taking my 4 points out of this one verse here, because there's a lot of power in this one verse. Do y'all see that, verse 4? Isaiah 43:4. Let's look at it a little bit deeper, and perhaps you can underline stuff or highlight it. But the first thing God said, he said he, God called his people precious in his sight. It's so much when we see that God gives this affirmation that his people is precious. He precious means that I know you in captivity today, but are you precious? You are valuable. He sees his people as valuable despite the fact that they were in captivity. He sees you today. He sees that you are valuable. Not only valuable, he sees that you are highly esteemed. When it says that you're precious, he said that I cherish you. He sees it all. Precious, he cherishes you. He's valuing you. In other words, he said, despite what you're suffering through, I still see you as all that. Okay, here we go. What I really celebrate here is the fact that God sees me. The Bible talks about God who sees in Genesis chapter 16, when Hagar was there and she was crying and she was there with Ishmael, and she didn't know that God seen her pain. She didn't know how bad her life was. And God said, I'm El Roy. El Roy means I am the God that sees. He sees you when you wake up. He sees you when you lay down. He sees you when you're crying. He sees you when you're suffering. He sees you when you celebrate. He sees you when you're sinful. He sees you when you get it right. He sees you when you get it wrong. God is the God that sees. He sees your every move, every moment. He never sleeps. He never slumber, but he always got his eye on you. God always sees you. He sees what that person did to you, how they rejected you, how they put you down, how they used you, manipulated you. He sees it all. God did not miss a thing. He sees it in great detail. God was watching all over you. That's why you're still here today, because God seen you. He had you. He was cherishing you. He was inviting you. He was highly esteeming you. God loved you so much. You said, hey, you are all that. God was watching over you. Psalms 139, verse 14, say it this way. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelously are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. Thus I'm precious in his sight, because he is my creator. He cared enough for me. It was a divine creation when God created you. He made your hair the way it is. He was counting. He made sure every freckle was counted, because he cared for you. He made you carefully. And despite what somebody else may say about you, God cared for you, and he see you. Since God was precious in my sight.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah.
He said, you precious in his sight, that he's watching you. And when he's seeing you, he's valuing you. Your net worth is not what you have gained here on earth. Your net worth is something eternal and heavenly. For the Bible said, you are a royal priesthood. Not only that, but he said, not only do he see you, but it said, thou has been honorable. God called you honorable. Meaning God called you brave. God called you noble. He called you a virtuous woman. He called you a man of valor. He said that you are very respectful, despite the fact that you embonished, despite what you're going through, despite you're not happy, despite there's not a happy new year, despite what's a happy birthday, despite the chapter didn't change and you're still going through mess. God said, Hollywood may not give you a star, Hollywood star, but I see you as somebody that's honorable. Here, let's check it out. In the book of Chronicles, the first Chronicles, chapter 4, verses 9 to 10, they wrote a whole book about us. Verse 9 to 10, they wrote it some years back. It was called Prayer of Jabez. Y'all remember that? The story goes this way, that Jabez's mama, we don't know her name, but we know his name, but the mama said, I'll bear him in pain. But the story goes, he didn't stay in pain because he prayed. And when he prayed, God was able to turn everything around. The Bible said that despite he was born in pain, and he caused pain, and he lived pain, and he walked around pain, but for somehow, some way, at a change of event, God changed the pain. And the Bible said that he was more honorable than his brothers. He was a man of valor. When they needed someone to fight, they went back and got Jabez. They put him aside. But even the Bible said that the stone that the builders reject have now become the chief cornerstone. Jabez was an honorable man despite all the struggle, all his pain. Jabez, he was an honorable man. And today, I don't know what you're going through in your life, but God sees you as a respectful person. He sees you as honorable. He sees you as honor. He sees you as noble. He sees you as brave. He sees you as a man of honor. He sees you as a virtuous woman. God's eyes is watching you. He sees you precious, and he sees you honorable. You're precious, and you're honorable. Well, what does this say? There's one verse that said, and I have loved thee. That's good news. That's good. That's great news. Because the word love here means agape. And the word agape means unconditional. There's no conditional. It's not he loved me because what I've done. The Bible didn't say that in 1 John 4, 19. He said, we love him because he first loved us. God love is not something that he said, it's not something that he said, it's rather something that he demonstrated toward us. For Romans 5 and 8 said, but God commended his love toward us that while we were yet sinners, that's when he died, that's Christ died for us. It wasn't based upon something that I've done, something that I got right. It wasn't based on none of those things. But God had agape love. He looked beyond who I was. He looked beyond my mess, beyond my sin, beyond my feelings, beyond my mess up, beyond how I rejected him. He looked beyond all of that, and he gave me unconditional love. Here it is, John 3:16, the Bible in a whole nutshell. For he so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. Listen, his love is so great it went beyond here on earth. His love is so great it went to everlasting. It flows further than here on earth. You can love your car today, but drive it 20 years from now. It's going to rust, it's going to fade. You can love your house today, but don't take care of what's going to happen. It's going to rust and fade. God love never rust. God love never fade. And even when you get put in the ground, his love expands beyond what's here, and it's everlasting love. God love you, and that's good news, because some people will turn their back on you. They love you one day. When you get it wrong, they won't love you no more. But my God love me despite of it. And I don't know who I'm speaking to today and how you feel on the inside, but let me tell you, God love you so much today that he was willing to give his only son, that if you were the only person who sinned, he still would have gave Jesus, because God loves you. Amen. Just in this one verse, I see a few things. I see that you are precious in his sight, in El Roy, the God that sees I'm valuable in his sight. I see that I'm honorable, I'm respectful, I'm brave. I see those things. I see the fact that God loved me. Therefore will I give men for thee and people for thy life. What is he saying? He's saying this, and this whole Bible is based upon this. Your whole life is based upon that one statement. This here it is. God will bring restoration to your life. Watch. The whole Bible is a book, is a story of restoration. It's the book of restoration. The whole Bible speaks about restoration. Okay, let's talk about it. Okay, Adam, God created. Adam what? Fell. Jesus sent the second Adam. What did he do? He restores. You got Old Testament, New Testament, whole Bible. It speaks about God bringing restoration. And today I feel that somebody may need some sort of restoration in life. But God began to bring everything that you've been through to a full circle and do this new thing in your life. And God will bless you and keep you and lift you up from where you're down. He will restore everything in your life. Don't look at what life looked like today. But the Bible says, the whole Bible speaks about restoration. And therefore, in some way, somehow, God is going to make that what the people meant for evil going to have to, it's going to have to turn around and be meant for the good. Here it is, Job, you can read the book of Job and see all the stuff that happened. But when you get to the 42nd chapter in verse number 10, it reminds us that after Job prayed for his friend, God gave Job double for all of his trouble. He lost a lot, but guess what? He got much more. God gave him double for the trouble. What was God doing? God was restoring to Job everything that he lost. If he was able to restore everything that Job lost, he's able this morning to restore everything that you lost. If he was able to do it for Joseph, he was able to do it for you. If he was able to do it for Moses' mama, he's able to do it for you. God got a track record of just keep restoring you. The Bible speaks about restoring you. And sometimes in life, I feel like I can't get that back. I lost that time. That messed up. That got jacked up. But God have a promise that something new is about to happen. And what's about to happen is new, that he's going to restore me. Psalms chapter 34 verse 19 say it this way. Cox, I think you like this verse. It said, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God will deliver you from them all. It does not matter what kind of afflictions you go through. God promised me that he will deliver me. He will restore me from all of my afflictions. Therefore, in verse 18, he begins to say, remember ye not the former things. He wasn't calling us to a greater level of amnesia that we're going to forget these certain things. But rather, he was calling us to victory over those things in the past. He said it is when it crossed your mind still, but it no longer hurts you. But it no longer tempt me. I got victory over it. It crossed my mind still, but it no longer controlled what I'm going to do. Because I knew. It's going to cross my mind, but I'm not stuck there no more. So if you want to bring it up and keep throwing it in my face, because I'm not stuck there no more. I know what happened. I understand it. But God is about to do something new for me. He's about to restore me, restore my soul. This is not by no fault or accident. However, even God promised new life. Everybody say new. Because it said here, but behold, stop, listen, I got to talk to you. This one to say, behold, don't move, you got to hear this. This is God, the prophet speaking right here. He's telling the people that's been in captivity for 50 years, now, behold, I will do a new thing. Everybody say new. That becomes very important because Apostle Paul said something, 2 Corinthians 5:17, he said that therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Somebody say new. Lamentation said it this way. Come to Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 22 and 23. It said it this way. It said, it is of the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed, because his compassion fail not. It said, they are new every morning. Everybody say new. His compassion is new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Say new. Ephesians 4:24 said this. And that ye put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. God put on a new man, a new woman. He put something new inside of you. I know the past happened. I know those things happened. But God is doing something new. Okay, go to Lord and Hancock. I'm just about finished. If those who want to help me end this out today, you can come. You want to do this song here. But as they come, if I look over in verse 20, this is what it says. And the beasts of the field shall honor me, and the dragons and the owls, because I give water in the wilderness and rivers in the desert to give drink to my people, my chosen. Listen, this whole development of the sermon did not start with verse 4, although my 4 points came out of verse 4. It actually didn't. I wasn't pulling from verse 18. It didn't come from verse 18, although it's different. We're not thinking so. Nah, it didn't even come from 19, where the topic new came from. It actually came from verse 20. Here it is again. The beast of the field shall honor me, the dragon and the owls, because I give water in the wilderness and rivers in the desert to give drink to my people, my children. Can I tell you something real quick? This is what it's saying to me. He lists three different animals. One, he lists a beast that's wild. He talks about the dragon or a jackal, which is in the wolf family. And he talks about the owl, which all three animals have a different behavior and characteristics. But yet they have one thing in common. That they're all trying to survive in the wilderness. And they do whatever.
Look at your neighbor, say,
say the Lord.
I gotta go, Dante.